I already upload the today handout slide in the Moodle. So for guys who attend the class late and cannot see the PDF share in the chat, you can access the file in Moodle. And yeah, all today's topics, the modeling, the dynamic modeling and state space description. I'm not sure if any of us have heard what is the state space description. Maybe in all vibration class, when we have like more than 1 degree of freedom, we write down the dynamic model in the metric form. We have the metric that relate to the inner shear, relate to the damping coefficient, and relate to the stiffness metric, if you still remember. Actually, the step space description is similar to that, but today we will see what is the state space description. And in the first bullet, the dynamics modeling, we will see, we will reveal from the 2 degree of freedom spring damper mass system. And we have the example in the rotational application or in the combination of the linear and rotational application. And we're gonna derive the dynamic model in time domain and see the relationship in the Laplace domain and derive it to be like a kind of the transfer function. And also we're gonna write it in the form of the state space description. So we have the dynamic model in time domain for multiple degree of freedom system. And we derive the transfer function in the Laplace domain. And an alternative is have the state space description model, which also in the time domain. And in the class, we mainly focus on control of linear time invariant system. Linear time invariant system. It means that the dynamic model gonna be in the linear equation. Time invariance means, the mass, the spring stiffness, the damping coefficient is constant against time, time invariant system. Linear is linear equation. So of course, many times we can see the system that the original dynamic model is not linear, but we're gonna try to linearize the model so that we still analyze the characteristic of the system by the method we study in the class. And we develop the controller for that system based on the linearized model. So linearization is also one important topic today. So let's begin from a simple system like this. We have mass one and mass two. The mass one has the displacement specified by the x1. The mass two also has its displacement specified by x2. And we apply the force to mass two. And with the effect of the damper and the spring, mass one also gonna move to the right-hand side. We have assumption to this. We had assumption to this. We don't know in the actual motion, maybe x1, maybe more than x2, but in the early state, you should imagine when the box, the mass one and mass two begin from zero velocity, and we apply the force to mass m2. Do you think what's gonna happen? Do you think x1 gonna bigger than x2, or x2 gonna bigger than x1 in the beginning? We directly apply the force to mass 2. So the mass 2 will begin to move first, and the spring gonna deform, the damper gonna deform. It may have a big distance between M1 and M2. And after the spring deform from the equilibrium, the free length of the spring, after the spring deform, it's gonna create the force to mass one and initiate the motion of the mass one. So in the step of the derivation of the math model, you may simply assume x1 is bigger than x2, but by physical meaning, if you consider the system, like it will be more realistic to assume x2 is bigger than x1. And the velocity of the mass m2 is also bigger than the velocity of the mass m1. For example, when it begins to move, we already have the velocity on the mass 2, but the mass 1 still doesn't move. And after that, mass 1 already moved. So before it begins to vibrate, this is still true. But in some, when the time passes, maybe if the spring begin to vibrate from the length that bigger than the free length, and then the spring is shorter than the free length sometime, at that moment, maybe x1 will bigger than x2, and x1 dot may be bigger than x2 dot. But let's assume this condition first. Why we need to assume this condition? We assume this condition so that we can write down the free body diagram of the system. When we consider mass one, of course the mass one has mg and has the normal force. The mass two also have mg and the normal force for the vertical force, but in this example, it's frictionless. Frictionless means we're not going to have friction here. And we apply the force to the mass M2. So between M1 and M2, what's gonna happen? What's gonna be the effect of the spring when x2 is bigger than x1? The spring will like be in tension. The spring will be, the length of the spring is bigger than the free length, and the spring is stretched. So the spring force will pull M1 to the right-hand side, and the spring force try to resist the motion of M2. And the magnitude of the spring force gonna be K. multiply by the difference between the displacement of x2 and x1. If x2 and x1 has same magnitude of displacement, x2 minus x1 gonna be zero, and the spring force gonna be zero. If x2 is bigger than x1, the spring force will be positive, which means the direction is as we assume. I'm not sure if you still can hear me.
Yeah.
Okay, yes. Okay, sorry. The screen showing your profile already disappeared from my screen. So I just worry that I lost connection. Thank you. And how about the damper? If we also assume x2 dot is bigger than x1 dot, do you think the damper gonna create force in which direction? The damper gonna pull M1 to the right hand side, and the damper gonna resist the motion of M2, and the magnitude of the damping force gonna be the coefficient multiplied by the difference between velocity. This is a free body diagram of mass M1 and M2. And to obtain the equation of motion, we apply the Newton's second law of motion and consider the motion in the x direction, because in the vertical direction, we don't have any displacement. The box is on the smooth surface and not moving up or down. So summation fx equal to max. Let's begin from M1. We have two forces that apply on M1 in the horizontal direction. K, x2 minus x1, and C, x2 dot minus x1 dot, will equal to M1, x1 dot dot. How about the M2? M2 have force Ft to the right hand side, and to the left hand side we have the spring force that resists the motion of M2, and we also have the damping force and it's gonna be the acceleration of M2. So from here, now this equation is written in time domain with time t. Can we simply transform the first and the second equation to be in the Laplace domain by assume zero initial condition? Zero initial condition means at time t equal to zero, x1 is zero and x1 dot is zero. No velocity, no displacement when time equal to zero. So to take the Laplace transform, x dot dot gonna be S square. And we move this term. So it's gonna be plus C of S. And we also move this term to the right hand side. It's gonna be plus K. Everything is related to X1 in the Laplace domain. And for the X2, yeah, we're gonna move X2 to the right-hand side of the equation also. We're gonna move X2 to the right-hand side of the equation also. C, with the first time derivative, gonna be C S K with X2 will be only K and X2 in the Laplace domain equal to zero. So in the Laplace equation, I try to separate the first coordinate and the second coordinate and the input force on the right-hand side of the equation. For the second equation, I'm gonna do the same way. We should have something that multiply by X1. And we should have another thing that multiply by X2. And relate to the right-hand side, which gonna be the input. For the first equation, we cannot see the effect of the input explicitly. We cannot find force in the first equation. So on the right-hand side of the Laplace equation, it's also zero. But for the second equation, you can see that we have force in the equation. So let's maintain the force when we transform with the Laplace transform with from Ft to Fs on the right hand side. It means we need to move this term and this term to the right hand side. So for X1, dot, the original symbol minus multiply by minus, it's gonna be plus, right? If it need to transform to the right hand side, plus gonna be the minus of CS. And for K, minus minus gonna be plus, and we move to the right hand side, it's gonna be minus. So here is K of X1. For X2, this already on the right hand side, but it have the second time derivative. So M2 will be S square. How about this one? We have minus C of X2 dot. When we move to the right hand side, it's gonna be plus C X2 dot, which means CS. And K of X2, when we move to the right hand side, it's gonna be plus K X2. So just K. And this is the plus. Now we have two Laplace equation for 2 degree of freedom system. So we can combine the two equations in one metric form equation, which relate to the first coordinate and the second coordinate, which equal to the input. So the first equation, consider the first equation, this one. On the right-hand side, it's zero. On the left-hand side of the equation, we have m1 s squared plus cs plus k that multiply to x1. And and we have this term that multiply to x2. So it's gonna be minus of cs plus k. This is the first Laplace domain equation. How about the second one? The second one is also simple. We have minus cs plus k. And the one that multiply by x2 gonna be m2 s squared plus cs plus k. And for the right hand side of the second equation, we can see the fourth input. So yeah, we may write like this, or the force will be outside the metric, but have the coefficient that multiply by the single input. This one is better. So this is the first equation that we derive the equation of motion in time domain. Equation of motion in time domain. Then apply the Laplace transform to get Xs as a function of the input force, and finally have the metric form. Finally have the metric form. How about the rotational application? Rotational application. We have this one with the moment of inertia, I1. And we have this two with the moment of inertia, I2. Between the disc, we have a torsion bar. A torsion bar. A torsion bar means it's like a torsion spring. A torsion spring. When the displacement, angular displacement, x1 and x2, if the this one and this two have the same angular displacement, the torsion bar is not deformed and not create any torque to the disc. But if we assume the torsion bar, if we assume the angular displacement theta 1 is bigger than theta 2. In this case, why I assume theta 1 is bigger than theta 2? We apply the torque. Actually, C is mean controller. D may be disturbance. But it's not that like important MC plus MD, MC plus MD, it's just the moment that input to the first disk on the left hand side. Why I assume theta 1 is bigger than theta 2? It because the output, the input torque that apply, we apply on the disk 1, and we firstly create the angular displacement theta 1. And after we have theta 1, the torsion bar deform, and it apply, it generate the torque to the disk 2 and create the theta 2. Actually, it's like here, we apply the force to x2 first, then the spring will generate the force to x1. So I assume x2 bigger than x1 because we apply force on x2. In this case, we apply the moment directly to the theta 1, and then it generates the rotation on theta 2. So yes, I assume theta 1 is bigger than theta 2. And the torsion bar here not only have the k theta, not only have the k theta, torque equal to k theta, theta 1 minus theta 2, torque from the spring, torque from the damper equal to the damping coefficient, angular damping coefficient multiplied by theta 1 dot minus theta 2 dot. The symbol here, they use K, use B. K means K theta. B means the damping, the torsional damping coefficient. So we assume theta 1 bigger than theta 2, and angular velocity of 1 is bigger than 2. So it seems like we have the left disk with the moment of inertia I1, and we have the right one with the moment of inertia I2, and we apply the input moment M. And if we consider the spring effect, if theta 1 is in the clockwise direction, theta 1 and also theta 2 in the clockwise direction. And if theta 1 is bigger than theta 2, do you think the torsion spring will create the k theta, theta 1 minus theta 2 in which direction to the I1? We consider this one with the moment of inertia I1. The disk has the input torque M and rotate with theta 1 and have a torsion spring and damper. If theta 1 is bigger than theta 2, the disk 2 try to resist the rotation of theta 1, which means the spring will resist the motion to the left disc, but the left disc is rotated in the clockwise, and theta 1 is bigger than theta 2. The spring try to rotate the second disc to the clockwise direction. Does that make sense? The action and reaction torque. Come back to this picture. Come back to this picture. We apply the moment in the clockwise direction to create the theta 1 in clockwise direction. With the inertia, of the I2, it's gonna resist the motion. And in the beginning, theta 2 is very small, but we already have the theta 1. It means the theta 1 go with bigger angle compared to theta 2. And the theta 2, this 2 try to resist the motion of the this one that is rotating in the clockwise direction. Resist the motion means in the torsion spring, it creates the torque in the counterclockwise direction to resist the input. But for the reaction torque that apply on the disc two, it's gonna be the moment in the clockwise, the reaction moment. And the magnitude of this moment, counterclockwise and clockwise moment, the magnitude will be the same and equal to the torsional stiffness multiplied by the difference between the angular displacement. Similarly, for the torque, which is the effect of the damper, rotational damper, the torque, which is the effect of torsional damper, gonna be C rotational multiplied by the theta 1 dot minus theta 2 dot. So if we apply the summation M equal to I alpha and clockwise is positive to the first disc. First disc has the input moment M. Input moment M. M is M controller plus M disturbance. The input moment M subtract by the resisting torque from the spring, K theta, theta 1 minus theta 2. And the resisting torque from the damper, theta 1 dot minus theta 2 dot. It needs to equal to I alpha. The this one has the moment of inertia I1. Alpha is theta 1. Dot dot. This is the first equation of motion in the time domain. If we consider the second disc, we don't have the input moment applied on the second disk, we only have the spring moment and the damping moment. And the spring moment and the damping moment create the clockwise torque to the second disk. So clockwise is positive. We have K theta with theta 1 minus theta 2 and C theta 1 dot minus theta 2 dot. And it needs to equal to the moment of inertia and angular acceleration of the theta 2. Now we have two equations. We're going to do the same way to transform the time domain equation to be the Laplace domain equation. And on the left hand side, going to be something that multiplied by the theta 1 in the S domain plus something multiplied by the theta 2. And on the right hand side, going to be the input M. Input M also in the Laplace domain. Now, this is the moment in time domain. We're going to transform the first equation and the second equation to be in this form. So now M already positive in the left-hand side, and the theta dot dot already positive on the right-hand side. So the idea is we're gonna move this term and this term to the right-hand side, and also the theta 2, we're gonna move to the right-hand side. So for theta 1, theta 1 dot dot, for the Laplace transform, it's gonna be S square. Theta 1 dot multiplied by C theta gonna be C theta S. And on the right hand side, K multiplied by theta 1. So we just have K. And theta 1 in the Laplace domain. How about theta 2? How about theta 2? The minus gonna be plus, but we need to change we need to move theta 2 to the right hand side. So it's gonna be minus C theta S of the theta 2. And minus gonna be plus. And when we move to the right hand side, it's gonna be minus. So plus K of theta 2. And the input need to be the Laplace transform of the input moment. How about equation 2? How about equation 2? We don't have input in the equation 2, right? And we already have the second order terms here. So we're gonna change this to here and this to here. And on the left-hand side, gonna be 0. So the begin from theta 1 and something multiplied by theta 2 equal to 0. If we need to move, if we need to move theta 1 to the right hand side, begin from this term, it's gonna be C theta first time derivative K theta and have the minus because it's on the right hand side. And if we consider the theta 2, I 2 S square as the effect of the second time derivative. For the first time derivative, it also positive when it is on the right hand side. So we have C theta S K theta 2 to the right hand side. Okay, K also K theta. Now we already have two Laplace domain equation. If we need to combine it in the metric form, multiply by the first coordinate and the second coordinate, and the input metric, input is M. From the first equation, this one, we have I1 S square plus C theta S plus K multiplied by theta 1 minus C theta S plus K theta multiplied by theta 2 equal to 1 multiplied by the input moment. From the second equation, we have minus C theta S plus K theta, and we have I2 S square plus C theta S plus K multiplied by theta 2 equal to 0. The cart has the linear motion. The arm is inverse pendulum, has rotational motion. So this system has 2 degrees of freedom and combination of the linear motion and rotational motion. If we draw the free body diagram of the cart, we have mg, we have reaction force on the wheel as the vertical force, we have the applied force, and we have the reaction torque between the pendulum and the cart at point P is the pin joint between the pendulum and the cart. And we also have an actuator that can create torque. And the torque gonna be the reaction torque that apply on the cart and the same magnitude of torque apply about point P on the pendulum. we also have the reaction force between the arm and the card. The reaction force has the vertical force and the horizontal force, same magnitude but opposite direction on each component. V has same magnitude but opposite direction. Horizontal H also same magnitude but opposite direction. The direction here is just the assumed direction. The actual force maybe have the same direction as we assume, or maybe on opposite direction. On the pendulum, we have the force, the reaction force at the pin position. We have mg. And this means the center of gravity is at this point. So the equation of motion gonna be obtained from summation fx equal to max. Summation fx equal to max. For the card, we have only the force to the right hand side and the reaction force to the left hand side. It should equal to m x dot dot. For the arm, how can we derive the position of the center of mass of the arm? We know that this distance is equal to L psi phi. This distance is equal to L psi phi. And X coordinate describe the displacement of the center of mass of the card. It means that the point P also move to the right hand side with the same displacement with the card. Point P has the same displacement x. Point P has the same displacement x, same velocity x dot, same acceleration x dot dot with the card at point P. But the x coordinate of the CG of the pendulum have the offset to the left hand side. Depending on the angle phi. So if we still use summation fx equal to max for the pendulum, the pendulum have the force h applied at point P equal to mass of the pendulum multiply by acceleration x. Acceleration x for the CG point
is equal to x minus L psi phi. Does that make sense? X position of CG of the arm always equal to the X of the card subtract by the offset L psi phi. So acceleration in X is equal to the second time derivative of xcg of the pendulum. So how can we obtain this second time derivative? For the first term, it's simple. We have m x dot dot. For the second term, m l. And d square by dt square of psi phi. So mx dot dot subtract by ml d by dt. The first time derivative of psi phi d psi is cosine, d by dt of phi is phi dot. D psi is cosine, d phi by dt is phi dot. And then d of the product, dip of the product, dip cos phi minus psi phi, dip phi is phi dot. When we keep phi dot as a constant, we consider phi dot as a constant and we dip cos phi, dip cos is minus psi phi and phi dot. And the second term, we keep cosine phi as a constant, and we dip phi dot. We're gonna have phi dot dot. So finally, the input, the H reaction force is equal to mx dot dot plus ml psi phi phi dot square ml psi phi phi dot square and minus ml cos phi phi dot dot. So from these two equation, can we relate x to the input force? H is the internal dynamics, internal force. Internal force means we may cannot see it by eye. It's not easy to measure. Of course, we can measure the applied force. We can measure the acceleration or displacement. But the reaction force inside the system the internal force, it's not easy to measure. So most of the time, we try to eliminate the internal force. And from the equation 1 and 2, of course, we can simply eliminate H. H is equal to F subtract by mass of the card X dot dot. So here, F subtract by M X dot dot. Can we relate X dot dot to the input force now? So FT is just equal to M plus M X dot dot plus ML psi phi phi dot square minus ML cosine phi phi dot dot. Now it's complicated. We can see the nonlinear terms. We can see sine, cosine, or even the second power of the time derivative. So as I mentioned in the beginning, in our class, we are going to tackle the problem linear time invariant system. So how can we make this equation to be a linear equation? In the end of the class today, we will talk about the linearization. How can we obtain the linear model at the operating point? But for this example, let's simplify this by assume the condition when the phi is very small. First, let's assume the condition when the phi is very small first. So when phi is very small, psi phi assumed to be phi, cosine phi assumed to be 1, cos 0 equal to 1. And when the angle is very small, the velocity also very small. So when we have the higher power, it's gonna be assumed to be 0. So by this assumption, seems like we're gonna have the linear equation. The force equal to the mass. The second term, when it assume the small phi, what we're gonna have? This term make it to be 0. So the second term gonna be 0 because we have the higher degree terms. And the third term here will be ML cosine phi is equal to 1 and have phi dot dot. Now the equation of motion here is very simple. We simplify it a lot by assume
the small angle assumption. It means this card arm, when we try to balance the arm to be like inverse pendulum, we have a card that can run to the left and the right and try to balance the arm to be in the vertical direction. If the arm tend to go forward like this, we may need to make an acceleration of the card to the right hand side to compensate the phi so that the phi become zero. So yeah, this application, if we want to maintain the vertical direction of the arm, the assumption of small angle phi is acceptable, and we can use this equation. But this system, how many degree of freedom of this system? Any idea?
Two?
Yes, we have X that identify the horizontal position of the card, and we have phi that indicate how much the pendulum deviate from the vertical direction. So this system has 2 degrees of freedom. We need at least, we need 2 independent equations to fully describe the system. Now we already have 1. We still need to compose another equation. We still didn't talk about summation moment about point P equal to the moment of inertia about point P, alpha. So we have the torque that apply in the counterclockwise direction about point P. And the effect of the mg, and I am not sure how can I simplify the effect of x dot dot. How can I simply explain the effect of x dot dot to you? If P is a fixed point, the torque, the summation of torque gonna be the torque. And when you consider mg, this is angle phi. This is angle phi. So mg psi phi, isn't it? The effect of the mg that create the moment about point P gonna be mg psi phi, and the distance, the orthogonal distance gonna be L.
equal to IP fee dot dot. Do you think this one is already correct? This equation is applicable when point P doesn't move or have constant velocity. If point P have constant velocity or doesn't move, this equation is applicable. But if point P also move with the acceleration x dot dot, if point P also move with the acceleration x dot dot, my technique is to consider the effect of the acceleration x dot dot is to the right hand side equation. The effect of the acceleration will make point P to the right hand side. It seems like we need to consider the effect of the acceleration here with M. X dot dot. In this case, maybe to make you can imagine, if we have two cases, the first case, the cart doesn't move, and the pendulum is in this posture, the cart doesn't move. The pendulum will drop down by the effect of mg, right? My question is, do you think if the cart accelerates to the right hand side with acceleration x dot dot, do you think the acceleration of the cart will increase the rate, will accelerate the growing of the theta, no, the growing of the phi, or it will decelerate the growing of the phi? In the first case, the cart doesn't move or have constant velocity. The pendulum just dropped down by the effect of mg. This is the first case. In the second case, the cart moved to the right hand side. Do you think in the first or the second case, the pendulum will drop down faster? Any idea?
The second case will drop faster.
Yeah, it seems like because of the effect of the acceleration of the reference frame, it seems like we have the effect of the acceleration to add on the original effect of the gravity. So, yeah, maybe when on the opposite way, you have the cart, your answer is correct. On the opposite way, if we have a pendulum that connect to the cart, And this is going down. It is going down. Do you think if you can move the card to the right and to the left-hand side to compensate the pendulum so that it still come back to the vertical or have smaller angle, do you think you should move the card to the left or to the right to make the angle become smaller?
To the left?
Yes. When we move the card to the left, it seems like we have the effect of this to compensate the effect of MG. And we can balance the pendulum. So maybe we need to set the, we need to set maybe the R theta coordinate to this and consider the moving frame. But this problem is not much complicated. So my suggestion is, hey, if the point P is moving to the right-hand side with the x dot dot, we may consider the effect of the acceleration x dot dot to the left-hand side is acceptable in our class. You don't need to try to derive. But if we have y dot dot in the upward direction, of course, it's clear. We're gonna combine y dot dot in the same direction with the G. It will increase the effect of G if y dot dot is positive. If y dot dot is positive to the upward direction, the effect of the acceleration will be my dot dot in the downward. And this gonna combine with the original MG. When you take the elevator upward, you can feel that everything become more heavy because you have the acceleration in the upward, and the effect of the acceleration will combine with the original MG. For the x acceleration, again, we can simply consider the effect of the acceleration as the force to the opposite direction. So when we need to consider the effect of mx dot dot, how can we obtain the orthogonal component of x dot dot? We have mx dot dot. And the angle phi here is equal to here, right? And this one, the combination of phi and alpha is 90 degrees. The combination of phi and alpha is 90 degrees. So this angle also have phi in magnitude because phi plus alpha is 90 degrees. Phi plus alpha is 90 degrees. So mx dot dot, and this angle is phi. The orthogonal component gonna be mx dot dot cosine. Phi. mx dot dot cosine phi. And the distance still be L. We need to add this one. And this one create the counterclockwise effect about point P. Create the counterclockwise effect about point P. So plus is still correct. How can we simplify this equation? How can we simplify it to be linear equation? To be linear equation. We have talked to the right hand side. And x dot dot gonna be to the right hand side with the minus m x dot dot cosine 0 equal to 1 and L is a constant. So ml x dot dot for this term, move to the right hand side. And the theta dot dot, no, the phi dot dot, the moment of inertia about point P and phi dot dot. How about this term? If we need to move to the right hand side, psi phi become phi, right? So we're gonna have mgl phi. So yeah, this is already linear equation. And we have two input of this system. We have the force input apply on the card, and we have the torque input between the pendulum and the card. We may set the torque to be zero if we just only to use single input to the system to balance the pendulum, or we can have an actuator to generate the torque here, torque T. In this slide, the last thing we're gonna do is to derive the Laplace form of the equation of motion. From the first equation here, the Laplace gonna be force is equal to m plus m s square xs. Minus ml s square phi s. This equation, torque in the Laplace equal to minus ml s square xs. And for the phi, moment of inertia, s square minus mgl and multiply by the phi in the Laplace. We have two equations in the Laplace variable. So yeah, you can compose this one in the terms of the coordinate x and phi. That relate to the input. The input. Input gonna be the torque and the force. The order, first or second, is not much important. You may compose the first one, or you may compose the second one first. But it need to be like correspond to the input. So yeah, this system is a little complicated, but what you can see in this example is this is the combination of the linear motion and the angular motion, and the model is not linear model. You need to assume the small angle assumption and make the equation to be the linear model. Should we continue or have a break? We can maybe more 10 minutes before we break, but this example is, I think it's simple. It's simple. The state space description means the state space description means we need to identify the state of system. We need to identify the state of system. And write down the relationship between the time derivative of the state with the state and the input of the system. And we derive the output of the system to the state and to the input. Maybe before we come back to the block diagram, let's begin from the most simple model that we are familiar with. All of us know this model. One degree of freedom model. The state space will be in time domain. We don't need to consider Laplace transform. The state space is in time domain. Maybe a good news for you. All of us know this simple model. All of us know this simple model. And this model has only one degree of freedom and one coordinate, x. But we have until x dot dot. We have until x dot dot. So we need at least two variables in the state space. Let me assume x1. Let me assume x1 equal to x. And let me assume x2 equal to x dot. By physical meaning, it means in this spring mat damper system with the applied force, we are paying attention to the position and paying attention to the velocity. If we only consider the position, or if we only consider the velocity, we can do it by adjust the C metric. But how can we compose the metric of the state space from this? we define x1 equal to x and x2 equal to x dot. The idea of the state space is we need to compose this one first. We need to compose this one first. D by dt of the metric, that is the state metric, is equal to the A metric multiplied by the state metric plus B metric multiplied by the input. If input is a single input, this is one term, but if the input have more than one input, the dimension of B need to correspond to the U. In this case, we have only single input. Maybe in the next example, we will see when we have more than one input. I want you to pay attention to the metric B, the dimension of metric B. So this one is the most important to form the state space model. How can we have d by dt of x1 and x2 equal to one metric A and multiply by x1, x2 plus one metric? The number of column equal to the number of input. Of course, we know that x1 dot d by dt of x1 is x1 dot. X1 dot is x dot is equal to x2. It's very simple. What is x2 dot? What is x2 dot? X2 dot is equal to x dot dot, right? X2 is x dot, x2 dot is x dot dot. How can we transform this equation to be x dot dot? X dot dot is equal to minus C per M. No. Minus K per M X minus C per M X dot plus 1 per M F. Is that correct? X dot dot means we divide the whole equation by M and we change Kx to the right hand side. It's gonna be minus K per Mx. We change C to the right hand side. It's gonna be minus C per M X dot. And the force also need to divide by M. So we already have this two equation. Can we apply this in the state space in the metric form? X1 dot d by dt, x1, x2, x1 dot, x2 dot. X1 dot equal to X2. X1 dot equal to X2. The first equation only this. The second equation, X2 dot is minus K per M multiplied by X1 minus C per M multiply by x2 and 1 per m multiply by the input. So we already have x dot. X is metric equal to a x plus b u. Now you already compose metric a and metric b, and you already select the state variable in the state metric. The state variable is x1 and x2. X1 equal to x position, x2 is x dot velocity. The state metric already have a is system metric. A is system metric. B we call input metric to identify how the input vector B input metric identify how the input relate to the state. A is a system metric because the component of A describe how the state one relate to the state two and describe how the state relate to the time derivative of the state. We call system metric. The most important metric that have only unique one is the A metric. The C and D metric, we can compose the C and D metric. In this case, if we want to control the position, y equal to it will be like this. If you want to control the position x, only one state is important, and the output metric y is cx plus du. The output metric depend on, hey, we want to control the position or we want to control the velocity. If you want to control the velocity, the output metric gonna be 0, 1. Here, D, we call the feed forward. If the input directly affect the output by some way, we're gonna have the feed forward. But if the input affect the output through the system, most of the time, the D metric gonna be the zero metric. The output metric depend on which state we are going to consider. Maybe sometime y may be equal to k1, k2 of x1, x2. Be careful. In the simple system like this, we may consider only one output of the system that relate to the first state or maybe relate to the second state. But sometimes we may need the combination effect of the state one and state two to show on the output. In that case, the output metric will have the component that is non-zero component. I'm not sure we're gonna have example of this or not in the maybe second half of the semester. I'm not sure if we have, but in the modern control, sometime we have. But in the basic system, we may consider only one state as the output that we consider. So when we come back to see the block diagram, to replicate the metric form, we have an input from the system, dynamic model of the system. We have input, we have the state. The output relate to the state by the C metric. C metric, we already named it output metric. A metric is system metric. B metric is input metric. X is the state. D is feed forward. Direct from the input to the output. If we have this, not depend on the state. In some system, the input directly affect the output and it's not depend on the state, not depend on position, not depend on velocity. The amount of input directly multiply by again and affect on the output. This is the feed forward. Okay, this should be enough before the break. After the break, maybe simple. I mean, we already have the hard part, hard definition and difficult example. In the second half of the class, maybe more relaxed. So let's have 10 minute break and come back by 2:55.